वेगवेगळ्या गोष्टी वाटतात पण प्रत्यक्षात जेव्हा कल्पना करतो पुढच्या पिढीच शिकायला मिळणार नाही. आणि इमॅजिन दॅट द नेक्स्ट जनरेशन फ्रॉम द रुरल एरियाज आर्ट बीन they won't be able to access art in any sort of, then where are we going to, like, is it the only urban community who is going to be artists and the creative people? That's a major question. And what about the indigenous and the vernacular understandings of aesthetics? So I think this is quite a serious note over here, that the way the government is acting in certain areas of education, which is rather not kind of disencouraging rather than being empowering the education sector. Since we are in the discussing in the context of UNESCO's art education, these are the ideas which are being actually promoted to through their policies. If you go to their website, and you will come to know that they have set out a lot of policies of how culturally diverse understandings should be promoted and their efforts being made. So so keeping those some of those guidelines in mind, the program has been devised. So we will take a short break for tea and refreshments here, and then we'll continue with the next session on the general semantics by Professor Dipesh Karmarkar. So the break should be will be of 15 minutes. So yeah, so I request you to come sooner. Thank you.
Thank Rachna Sansad for providing us with this opportunity and the venue. The event has been, this is the third year of the event, and we would continue to do this annual program every year with different concepts, and so that the audience is exposed to different ideas every year. I thank Dr. Karmarkar and Humkar Kadu for presenting us with the insights into their areas of study. And also Mr. Hiraman Patil for giving us a short overview of what the current state of art education at school level is right now. And I also thank all the technicians, cameramen who have helped us making this happen. Thanks a lot. And this was not the last, the audience who have taken the time to be with us and graciously been present here for throughout the program. Thank you.
I request Dr. Karmarkar to present his lecture. Before we continue, I would just like to add a note what we were discussing earlier. The idea of looking at what's happening at the ground level, last year also, we had Imarthi sir speaking about out of his experience. Imarthi sir traveled almost all the art colleges in Maharashtra later, and eventually even in Rajasthan and other places. So when we are looking at art education, primarily what we are kind of concerned with urban art education, and kind of we are also discounting the sensibilities which are present in the inherently present in the vernacular mediums. So hence considering not only about speaking about ideas and great theories of art and practice, but we also need to address these issues, and rather at least be aware of it while enacting on different issues. The next topic would really make us rethink and revise our positions when we are thinking of the idea of meaning making and how we present ourselves in the society and what we really are. Because art, in most cases, it is some sort of Herbert Reed says, it is nothing more than bread and butter. So are we giving it more undue importance, or is it less valued? Quite a complex situation we always debate with. And again, being in an urban scenario, we are hardly touched with many other issues which otherwise people face. Like even if we just go to a smaller town, not necessarily a rural place, these are the queries which we are constantly facing. So I invite Dr. Karmarkar to present his lecture, and there will be a question and answer session of that. And after that, there will be a small feedback session. A short survey will be conducted, and we'll conclude after that. Thank you.
At the outset, first of all, I thank Mr. Nikhil Purohit and Mr. Mahendra Damre for giving me this opportunity, because many of you may be, you know, feeling that why general semantics in a, you know, in an art related program. But as just now Nikhil said that as art has a lot to do with how we experience the things and what kind of meanings that we generate, I think from that particular point of view, general semantics is extremely relevant. Before we start, I want you to go in a small kind of minute silence and try to ask these questions to yourself so that I can begin. Last two points are note. The first point you will understand by the end of this presentation. That presentation is my abstraction and therefore it is incomplete. I don't claim any expertise on general semantics. I'm absolutely learning it, and whatever I'm presenting is what I have understood of general semantics. Another very important confusion right in the beginning, I want to clear that semantics and general semantics are different things. Though semantics is very much tangibly related, is a part of general semantics, but semantics is not general semantics. So they're two completely different things. So with that understanding, let us begin. Now the whole idea of general semantics was put forward by Alfred Korzybski. It's called as the father of general semantics. And you can see that as we proceed, that the entire the scheme, the system of general semantics talk about how we think. It raises the question on about ourselves, our own thinking, and it tries to guide us for how sensible thinking is possible and how that sensible thinking will make it easier for us to really act as human beings. So the title of the presentation is Introducing General Semantics. So I am only introducing this general semantics to you. In my college, where I conduct an entire certificate course on general semantics, it's a 60-hour course, out of which about 30 hours are only for the theory of general semantics and 30 hours for applied general semantics. So that 30-hour theory part, I am bringing into 1 hour kind of a nutshell. So I am trying to give an outline. And as I am compressing the time, it's very much going to be a bit heavier. And therefore, I request you to give fuller attention to it. Albert, let me give a brief, because it's always said that to understand art, it is necessary to know the artist. To understand a play, it is necessary to know the playwright. So same, a very brief about Alfred Korzybski. Alfred Korzybski was a Polish man. That is, he was Polish by origin. And he was born in Poland, which was at that time in 1879, which was under Russia at that time. And he belonged to a family of a nobleman. So he was belonging to a family of absolutely rich, rich family background. Now, since his childhood, Korzybski used to have a prolonged period of silence, which their parents' accounts tell us. Now, therefore, since childhood, this man was quite different than others, and he was always in a mood of contemplation, being in silence, thinking about, you know, himself or thinking within himself. Now, this Alfred Korzybski, by training, was a chemical engineer, and he joined in about 1914, he joined Russian army to be a part of the First World War. Now, when he took part in the First World War, and as his biography tells that he suffered tremendous pain, lot many wounds when he was a part of the war. At the same time, he observed destruction, chaos and conflict all around him, and which led to question in his mind that how could this have been done? Why this war and why this chaos and destruction and violence? And he started pondering on this particular question, started to, you know, finding out answer in his own way or by being silent of what is the reason behind all this destruction. By the end of World War, he was transferred to United States as a war lecturer, where he started giving lectures on war and the ideas which he was thinking about. And in New York, in another photograph you can see, it's a Woolworth building, the then highest building in New York. And he went on the terrace of this building and just saw the panorama of New York. And he saw that so many achievements, so many good things which human beings have done, so many buildings and infrastructure and roads and vehicles, so much of prosperity. He again came across the same question, that how could this have been done? So he realized that human beings are capable of doing two completely opposite things. On one side, absolute destruction. On one side, there is very much creative construction. Now, how this is possible? How a human being can do these completely two opposite things at the same time? And he was very much worried about the entire humanity as far as the world war and the related situation is concerned. Now, I will take you to the journey of how Korzybski revealed the answers to these questions. So that is the way I am going to, so that not thematically, but as a thought process. So these are the questions, that's the background which I am giving you. He realized another thing from that building, that the science and technology is developing very fast on one side, but is society ready to handle that progress in science and technology? Why on one side society is completely broken by beliefs, traditions, customs, which are age old, which are unscientific in nature, doesn't have any very empirical meaning in that. And on the other side, we find developments in science and technology. So we found that the physical sciences, the natural sciences, are growing exponentially, while the growth in society is very much arithmetic. So why there is a gap between how the science is developing and how the society is developing? All this he is thinking in the light of that question, that how it can be done, how the man can be, you know, both ways acting. So he understood that man is becoming more unseen day by day, that the insanity is taking over the sanity of human beings, and which is actually a self-destructive, because it is destructing the human race, destructing the humankind. And so he was very much related, or he was very much keen to understand that why and what is wrong with this and how can this be prevented. He was an engineer, and therefore he had seen that during wartime, that how a bridge can be built so fast with a teamwork. So he feels that why a bridge can be built in such an easier way, but why it is so difficult to build peace. I hope you are understanding the background. If you are not understanding, please tell me, because it's a very logical way of understanding. So if you have any problem, then it will be difficult for you to understand the next part. Is it clear? This is the Korzybski's quest. That why humanity is suffering, what's the problem with it, and how we can save humanity from insanity and bring humanity to sanity. That's the whole idea which Korzybski was pondering, with which he raised another question. What makes us humans? If you also try to give a bit thought, what makes us humans unique, distinct than other animals? Number of things may come in your mind, but you will find that so those things are also there in case of plants and animals. What is so unique? For 2 years he was thinking of that. And then when he got the answer, he came up with this three-tier classification. He said that plants are plants because they can bind chemicals. Right? Animals are animals because they can bind space. I hope you're understanding. Because they can move around. Plants cannot. And human beings are human beings, not because they have evolved brain and all, but because they can bind time. This is the fundamental idea of general semantics, that human beings are time binders, by which I mean that humans have the capacity to transmit from one generation to another generation. Right? Wherever the earlier generation has left off, we pick a thread from there and we continue the journey. Okay? So from one generation or from one person can begin where the other left off. So he said man is not an animal. Man is a time binder, which puts him completely different or very unique as compared to plants and animals. So he is trying to differentiate between, because insanity or insane behavior is a very animal-like behavior. So why humans are behaving so animal-like? And I'm interested in general semantics because 1914 when he raised the question, and in 2017, like we are developed as far as our insanity is concerned. Mm-hmm. If you look around, just read today's paper and you will understand that. So Korzybski's questions are still relevant. It's not that it was something of 1920s. The same questions can be raised even today, and we can try to understand the answers for those questions. So he has understood that human beings are basically time binders. By time binder, we mean that nothing belongs to us, right? We are not self-made. Everything is not created by us. Something is created by our forefathers, ancestors, and we are building upon that, whatever we have received from the earlier generation. Clear? Okay. So this is the entire idea. Now the question is, are we efficient time binders? Because Korzybski connected straight away with this. Humans are time binders, right? We are not binding time efficiently, and that's the reason why we are moving towards this insanity. That is why we are moving more, behaving like animal-like, because we are less than human, because we are forgetting to bind time, which is a unique feature of the identity of being human. And therefore he said that humanity is in its childhood. I hope you are understanding. From ages, right, human beings were behaving like an animal. And therefore humanity was in a childhood. That's what Korzybski thought in early 20th century. And so he thought that how this humanity can be developed further. Okay, to what we call, what he called as The Manhood of Humanity, which was his first book, published in 1929. Now the name itself suggests that he was talking about how this humanity can be brought from childhood to manhood. Are you understanding what I'm saying?
Yes.
I hope you are with me. I mean that how human beings can be made saner, than what they are today. Okay, the reason is we have forgotten that we are human beings. We have forgotten that we are time binders. Clear? Then two important questions comes up. First, because now our question is how to bind time, because we have forgotten our own nature, right? So how to do that? So there are two questions now logically comes. First, how do we experience? I think this is where the art and all these things will very much come. So how do we experience? That then becomes information, knowledge, etc., which then we transmit, right? What I experience, I transmit it to you. Whatever I have experienced as general semantics, now I am transmitting it to you. Correct? So the question is how I understood general semantics. That is important for you to know, to understand what I am delivering, right? So how do we experience, number one, and number two, How do we transmit that experience? Clear? So you are standing on a road and you saw an accident. So how do you experience that accident as a viewer? And when after 2 hours, when you go home, how you describe, narrate that accident to your family member or a friend? So that you are transmitting it. Something has happened at in time A and in time B, you are giving that narration to someone. Understanding? These two things, according to Korzybski, are extremely important to understand, to know what time binding is and how efficient time binding is possible. And therefore, in Science and Sanity, which is known as the Bible for general semantist people, which was published in 1933, where he actually talks about an entire full-fledged system of general semantics, where he wrote that we are interested in humanity to know how we know, even than what we know. Today we are in the age where we are interested how that what we know, right? How much people know, that's become more important. The question is how we know that, how we experience that, how we transmit that. That is extremely important for Korzybski. In 1938, he founded Institute of General Semantics, which is still living organization. I will talk a bit about it at the end of my presentation. This much is clear. Now I am entering into the fundamentals of general semantics. Now to understand, now we are addressing the first question. How do we experience? That is our first question, which we are trying to understand. Now while understanding that, Korzybski said that we are actually a part of the process world. Right? You can see in the picture that there are two kind of worlds. One is the world out there, world which is outside of me, and world which is inside of me. So there is world out there and there is world in here. That is world inside me. Okay? So you can see that earth represents the outside world, the absolute reality as it is existing. Now you can see there is a human figure and which is absorbing the reality, external reality. How it is done? It is done through senses, through our sense organs, right? So we see, we hear, you know, we smell, we feel, we touch, and through all these sense organs, we try to experience the things. We try to experience the reality. Clear? And through when we experience that reality, we construct our own world the way we have experienced it. Understood? The same accident is seen by, say, 5 people. But if you hear their narration, you will find that they are giving different narrations, these 5 people. The reality is same, but they have absorbed it, experienced it differently. Right? Which leads to creation of 2 worlds, world out there and world here in my brain, right? Which is creating meaning out of it. No, meaning out of what my sense organs are sensing. Clear? And there comes the role of brain and nervous system and sense organs and all that. I will not go into much detail, but only I will touch these because this is an important part. Ask these questions to yourself. Is it that what I hear, see, smell, feel is out there? I can see a rose. A rose is red. That rose is red is my conception. Is it really that the rose is red? That's the question in the first point. Is it that whatever I see is actually out there? Then we understand that is not so. Is the light that goes on that flower comes back to my retina and then my retina creates a picture and I understand that it is red. There may be a person who is color blind. For him, that flower may be green, may not be red. So the rose is red becomes my reality, which is different from the reality of some other person because he is experiencing it completely different. So in reality, the rose is red is the reality for me. But it's not the reality which is actually out there. Understand? Yes? Difficult. Yes. Okay. Do I hear, see, smell, feel all that is out there, right? We all have come from this gate to this auditorium, right? You have seen while coming around. Have you seen everything? Right? Have you seen a broom which was kept just in the corner? You might not have seen. So whenever we see, it's not that we see and absorb everything, right? Whenever we hear, we don't hear everything. You might have experienced that sometimes certain sounds we hear, but the other person says that he is not hearing that sound. But you feel that you are hearing that particular sound, right? This tells us that the capacity of our sense organs, are absolutely limited. And how limited they are vary from person to person. What I can see, it's not necessary that you will see the same thing. What I can hear, it's not necessary that you will see hear in the same intensity. Getting my point? So Korzybski realized that the way our brain, nervous system and sense organ function, he has went much in detail on understanding brain and all, okay? And he realized that our human senses are limited. So the question, how do we experience, okay? We progress one step ahead by understanding that whatever we experience is limited. Whatever we experience is only the experience for me. The same experience is not for the other person. Right? Because the way the brain functions is such that brain cannot experience what we call sub-microscopic events. Right? This is a bottle. You can see that this bottle is stationary. It's static. Right? But at sub-microscopic level, there are so many things which are happening. Right? There are atoms and nuclei which is moving. Okay? So this bottle is actually very dynamic. It's not at all static. But we cannot see that. Right? And therefore we feel that the bottle is very stationary. What brain does is, brain just takes a snapshot with the help of all our sense organs. Right? Because brain is not in a position to understand the whole process world as process. Getting my point? So when you see an object, you see an object as a static entity. You don't understand that object as process, right? Though the object is made up of processes, so many going inside. Clear? Okay. Now this is a famous picture, and you know that we have right brain and left brain, and they do, you know, completely different functions and all that. But understand that this particular part, which we call the cerebellar cortex, which has got these two hemispheres, right and left. And as you know, that is a two completely separate hemisphere, and there are two very important organ just in the center, which you can see, called as thalamus. Can you see that?
Yeah.
In the mid part of the brain. Now this thalamus is the organ which receives signals from all our sense organs. Clear? And those signals received are transmitted to the cortex, which is the largest part of the brain. Okay? And in the cortex, you find that all that signals that we receive are processed, and the entire work of giving meaning is done there. Depending upon, then we say ki kiska right part, you know, stronger hai, kiska left part stronger and all that. But the entire concept of consciousness, language, creativity, aesthetic, all which is processed there in the cortex, the signal goes from thalamus. The research has shown that there is a time lag. There is a time lag between when I see the thing, okay, when the signal pass on to the thalamus, when thalamus sends that signal to the cortex, and the cortex generates the meaning out of it. Understanding what I'm saying? There is a time that takes to complete this process. Okay? Now this time actually leads to what we call as the thalamocortical disintegration. Okay? Because we are habitual, my questions in my first slide. We are habitual to jump to conclusions. We just see a person from outside and we create an opinion about that person without knowing what that person is. But just out from the outer, you know, how the person looks, we create an opinion. Now this kind of jumping on conclusion is, you are not giving time for your brain to actually process the signals. In Marathi we have a proverb, ki kutlai vela daha akade moza. Count 10 numbers, no, before you say or before you react. That's what Korzybski is talking about. That counting 10 numbers is because the brain that takes the time to process, so that this right and left, which are two different hemispheres, need to coordinate with each other and integrate the information and create a more holistic meaning. Now for this kind of an integration, we require this what we call as the delayed reaction. Okay? Right? I'm not going to further detail. But this tells us that human senses are limited. Okay? Brain has a limited capacity to process the things. Right? We don't see everything. We don't experience everything which is out there. So what we are doing, when we look at, when I'm looking at you, I'm only looking at the chairs, or I'm only looking at you. But there are so many chairs which are empty. I'm not looking at them. Right? I'm looking at them, but those are not getting registered in my brain. I'm only looking at you people who are listening to me. So what I'm doing, I'm actually removing certain part. Right? I'm deleting certain part. I'm ignoring certain part, certain portion from the reality, from outside world. This process, Korzybski called abstracting, another fundamental principle. And we, everybody, we are abstracting. We cannot escape from that. Okay? When we listen something, no, see, number of times it happens that we hear something and then we take a meaning out of it, and then there are so many misconceptions created. Right? And when you go back to that person, the person says that I don't mean that. Okay? So why there is a miscommunication? The person means something, the same words you are hearing, but you mean something else. Okay? It is because there is a process which is going on of creation of meaning. Okay? And in this process, is Korzybski is calling the process of abstracting, the process of leaving out details. Okay? And therefore Korzybski says that don't say that the world is an illusion. World is not illusion, but world is an abstraction. The world that we see is how the brain has abstracted it. So it's my image. It's a product of my abstraction, which may be completely different from the abstraction which you all are making. Then there is diagram of abstracting. Let us not go into that. This is what I'm talking about briefly. So there is the real world, which is the world out there, right? That real world we absorb through senses, okay? We carry out, we do the abstracting part, experiencing part, and how we transmit that experience through language. Here comes the semantic component, okay? And then comes the part of language. So through abstracting and language, we process our experience, and then we construct our world. Our is my own world, which is my perceived world. How I perceive the reality, which is constructed through language, symbols, and so many things. So which is a world in my brain, which is world in here. So this is how we produce inner world from the outer world through this entire process of abstracting or experiencing. To understand this better, Korzybski made a kind of a model, which you can see, it's a photograph of the same model which Korzybski made. The model called as, it's named as structural differential. This model has got a US patent also in 1925, a very famous model in general semantics, and something which is one of the fundamental concept. Let us understand this model quickly. You can see that this model has 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 parts. And actually it continues. You can see the sixth part is broken. So that is just to show the continuity. The topmost part is actually what we call as a parabola. Right? So it's open from the top. It's a parabola made of rug. Rug, you know, have number of holes. It's a very coarse kind of material. So it has got number of holes. Korzybski said that this parabola represents the world. Parabola represents the world out there. He calls that level as the event level. Right? There are so many events taking place at macroscopic and sub-microscopic levels also. So each and every hole in that parabola represents each and every event, whatever is happening around. Right? Okay? Now, in the second level, which is in the round shape, is called as the object level. Right? It means that object level is the first level. Yes, one thing I forgot. Event level, remember, there are no words. There is no language. Everything is non-verbal. Right? Because just world is out there. I don't know about all that. So it's absolutely in a non-verbal format. When I see something, then I enter into object level. I see something, my eyes catches something, or my ear hears something. So that is the first interaction with the world, right? Which is called as object level. Now this is also a very non-verbal interaction. Because I am just seeing it, I am not creating any meaning, I am not thinking about it. It's the first interaction between, say, a light and the retina, with which I can see. So which Korzybski called as object level. Now, can you see that there are certain strings? And there are some strings from event level to object level, which are connected to each other. So these are the things, these are the events which you can grasp. Say those events which are connected are all of you, as far as I am concerned, because I am seeing you, right? But I am not seeing those empty chairs. Yeah, right? So all those empty chairs are like those dots which are not connected by any string. So I am leaving out those details. Right? But the empty chairs do exist. But I'm leaving out those details. I'm abstracting. I'm only seeing whatever I want to see, rather. Okay? And that is what an object level. Right? And I can see through my senses. So the last word says sensory impact. Okay? And certain words, certain strings you can see are freely hanging from the parabola. They're not getting connected to the object level. Right? Okay, so again, these are the things which I cannot grasp. No, I cannot grasp through my senses. So, though you can see that there is no connection between the parabola and the object level. Understood this much? The third level is called as the descriptive level. I have sensed it and now I am describing it. This is the first verbal interaction with the world. Okay? Now remember, verbal doesn't mean only when I describe. When I start thinking, I am entering into a verbal world. So I started thinking about something that I have seen. So with the thinking begins, I am entering into a verbal world because I think in my language. Right? So that becomes the level of description. And here, the process of evaluation begins. You start evaluating the things, right? On the basis of the filters, right? Which religion you belong to, which caste you belong to, what is your language and what is your social background, economic background. So on so many filters, what are your political ideas? On the basis of so many filters, you try to evaluate the thing. So actually the information is processed, right? In the level D. Next level, which I said that these are infinite levels, which are called by Korzybski as I1, I2, say up to IN. So that I stands for the inferences. So the inferences I draw, from that. Clear? Something which may not be the reality. I may not know whether I have not proved it empirically, but I have inferred that this and this thing is like that. Okay, so that is my inference. Okay, whenever I look a cow, for example, I suddenly remember BJP. Now in reality, the cow has nothing to do with BJP. It's an animal. Okay, but that is the way a person infers. Okay, And a person of CPI may look at cow differently. The person with BJP may look at cow differently. These are all inferences that we built, which are not there in real world. These are constructed by us as per the way those things are processed in our brain. Okay? And those the number of cards I1, I2, I3 shows that the same thing is abstracted at different levels. You can see the arrow which shows that increasing abstraction levels. Right? More the number of labels, higher is the abstraction. Understanding? Okay? I see a cow, then I think yes, cow can give milk. So I categorize cow as a milking animal. Then I think yes, cow is a milking animal, is something to be domesticated. So cow becomes a part of livestock. Are you understanding what I'm giving? I'm giving labels to that. Okay, if it is a livestock, then we say, okay, it's a wealth for a farmer. The person who is doing livestock, cow is a wealth. Okay, so at every level, I'm abstracting. And jitna main abstract karte jaunga, reality se main dur chala jaunga. So Korzybski is showing a kind of a dangerous sign that higher the abstraction, okay, you will be further away from the reality. Okay, the arrows are important. Arrow show that this side arrow, which goes back to parabola, which shows a feedback, or it shows the factor of time. Okay, because whatever I have experienced, that finally affects my own experience next time. Understanding what I mean? Okay, I'm going from a road and I suddenly come across an area of where the buildings are largely painted in a green color, right? There are women who are in burqa and with the men with some caps. Now I'm just looking at that, right? But that suddenly will bring in my mind that I am in a region where a particular religion is dominant, right? How I understood that this is connected with a particular religion? Because of my inferences drawn before. So the inferences that I have drawn before are influencing my experience in future. Are you understanding that? Okay, certain beliefs, right? That a particular thing is like that, right? A person A is lazy. This is my belief. I've experienced it when I gave person A some work, right? But when the time comes next time to give some work to A, I'm giving the work thinking that the person is lazy. But a person may do that work efficiently this time. There may be some reason why he was lazy earlier. Right? But I don't do that. I keep that inference in my mind, you know, which affects the experience. Clear? So these are the four levels. Understand that. Something happens. Clear? Event level. I sense what happens. Object level. Both these levels are non-verbal. I recognize what happens. This is the first verbal understanding of the world. I generate meaning for what happens. Understood the process? पहले हमने देखा brain में क्या होता है, okay? और brain में होने के वक्त how we give meaning to it, how we experience the things, right? आपको लगता होगा थोड़ी इतना सब कुछ होता है when जब हम experience करते हैं. Right? That's the whole problem Korzybski is talking about. That we are not aware of all these things which actually happen. Right? And which makes us, which keeps us away from the entire process of time binding. This is clear? Okay? I hope next slide is clear also. This is very important. Something happens is not what I have sensed. Understood? Whatever is there in the outside world is not all that I have sensed. I have only picked up something. Okay? Now, whatever I have sensed is not what I recognize, because I may not recognize everything. Right? Because I have not experienced it before. So, certain things I may not recognize. Right? Certain things I may not describe. We say, you know, sometimes ki mi shabdat nahi vyakta karu shakat. I can't express in words. Right? So you cannot experience, you cannot express certain things, you cannot recognize certain things. Okay? So, and whatever you recognize, okay, is not the meaning, because meaning goes through number of filters. Are you understanding how you go away from the level one, from whatever is there outside, and how the meanings are generated in that? This is called a structural differential. Okay, this is what the structure of experience is. Not experience, structure of experiencing is. How we experience structure. 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay, and every level differentiates from the other level, creating the gaps. Okay, in experiences. This is the first question. Now the last second question. How we transmit? So first of all, we have experienced something limited. We have grasped something very limited. Okay, and on the basis of filters, we have created some meanings, our own world. Okay, now how I will transmit that to the other person? We know that language is the principal tool that facilitates this transmission of knowledge. That's what time binding is. When the knowledge of one person is transmitted to other. Okay, so without language it's not possible. Now the question is whether it is structurally similar. See if you can understand this quote. If we reflect upon our language, we find that they must be considered only as maps. Korzybski calls language as map and reality as territory. Understanding that you have a map of Bombay, you have a map of Mumbai with you. Okay, is this map is territory? No, it's a map. It's a map which is at reduced scale. Right? It's a representation of the ground, but it is not the ground. Understand? This is the concept which Korzybski is talking about here. Okay? It happens sometimes. Ki aap Google ka map follow karte karte jaate ho, you can see that there is a left turn. When you actually go there, you find there is no left turn. Right? Okay? It means that the structure of the reality and structure of the map are different. Correct? And therefore you are misled. You are misguided. Right? You may not go where you want to go. Because the map which you are following is structurally different than, okay, the actual territory. Is this clear? Apply same thing to language and reality. Okay? What reality kaisa maine bola aapko ki it's a process world. Clear? It's a process world which we cannot grasp everything. So is it that your language also can grasp everything and describe everything as it is? If you are seeing a flower, can you describe the flower as it is to your friend so that the friend will have the same aesthetic experience of this person? Understand what I'm saying? Okay, it is because your language cannot express that, exactly that what you see, exactly that what you experience at non-verbal level. Understand that? Now that creates a gap in transmission. Okay, that creates a problem to which I have called it as the problem of language. Korzybski studied the language and understood that most of our languages are based on the Aristotelian logic. Okay, our all Indo-European languages, for example. And those are based on Aristotelian logic. Okay, just ke teen basic rule I have taken, see whether you understand that. Law of identity. A is A. First Aristotelian logic. Truth is a truth. That's an example. Okay, what we do, we are identifying something. Okay, but Mr. A is criminal. What are we doing? We are identifying Mr. A with criminal. Right? Mr. A is Hindu. Mr. B is Muslim. We are identifying it. So the word is, the verb is, Korzybski said, is a highly problematic verb. Because that verb identifies the two things as same. A is equal to A. Next comes the law of excluded middle. Either A is equal to B or A is not equal to B. There cannot be any middle ground. Okay? Either truth or not the truth. Okay? Ye jo hai, wo truth ho sakta hai ya truth nahi ho sakta hai. Right? There is whole Indian mythology, you know, which says that how the myths are created. And if you have listened to Devdutt Patnaik, then he always says that how the meanings are created and how those meanings are described through our mythology. Okay, where he defines myth as the truth for me. Myth is a truth for me. That may not be a truth for you. So it's a truth constructed by me. But in the Aristotelian language, okay, it either can be a truth or it is not truth. Third is law of non-contradiction. Not both. Truth and not the truth. It cannot be both. Right? Something cannot be male and female both. Right? If you see our administrative forms, admission form and all that. Gender, male, female, there cannot be a third one. No transgender, now we have added it. Okay, but since beginning it was only two categories. So either this or this, there are only two things possible. Married or unmarried, no third category. There are only two things which are possible. Right, so that is a very Aristotelian logic of understanding. That there is no contradiction at all. Either this or this, and it cannot be both. Now, all our language systems are based on these fundamental, our grammar of language is based on this fundamental Aristotelian logic. And therefore, Korzybski says that the verb to be is highly problematic, and therefore he suggests to remove the verb to be from our language. Because to be creates identification. So when we say Joe is a criminal, so we are equating one noun Joe with another noun criminal. And then we say that both are same. And there is another ease of projection. Hum kiska adjective thop dete kisi ke upar. That Johnny is bad. Okay. So adjective hai which we are like superimposing on that person. Right. That he is bad forever. The person is bad forever. Right. He cannot change. He is lazy means he is lazy forever. Okay. So the entire problem is related to ease. Another problem, jisme main nahi ja raha hun, that is subject and predicate relationship. Okay, can you separate heart from heartbeats? Right, heart is a doer, heartbeats is a function. We can't separate the two. But in language, when you express that, okay, you say that the heart is beating, as if heart is different and the beating is different. So he said that a subject-predicate relationship also brings a very asymmetrical understanding of our world, where we try to separate, differentiate the doer from what he does. I hope you are understand. It's pretty heavy. You know that. Okay. First, our experiences are limited. The way we transmit also has a problem. Now understand हम कैसे experience कर रहे हैं, कैसे meanings हम generate कर रहे हैं. Okay, I'm also skipping this. These are some funny examples. You can see that the below one. Press any key to start. Girl is searching where is the key called any. There is no key on the keyboard called any. Our language is absolutely confusing. Okay, and the first one also. Are you sure this is how we get data into the clouds? Right? Because you mean something, the other person means something. Okay? And grammar helps all this confusion. Same for sign languages. Right? I hope this you know, and there are so many images on internet. One single sign knows different. Right? If some foreigner asks you that how I look, and if you say give this sign, because we mean that this is beautiful. Right? But for her, that lady, this may be something else. No, depending upon from what culture she comes from. Okay, so even the sign languages we see have problems because they have different, their own cultural meanings. So let us revisit our question. How do we experience? We have seen that. Now the next question is really important. Do we behave with the awareness that what we know is incomplete? हम बोलते हैं ना हमेशा नहीं ये मुझको मालूम है यही ऐसा ही है बराबर है दिस इज व्हाट हैज हैपेंड राइट ओके राम इथे जन्मला होता है ये इथेच राम मंदिर राइट सो यही है ये जो है वो इधर ही है राइट काइंड ऑफ गेटिंग माय पॉइंट वी डोंट कीप स्कोप दैट सम अल्टरनेट इज पॉसिबल सम अल्टरनेट रियलिटी सम अदर ट्रूथ इज पॉसिबल Okay? And we cannot know everything at one point of time. Right? The problem is that now Korzybski has shown that how our experiences are limited and how we cannot experience all. Now he is saying you should behave with that awareness that whatever I know is incomplete, whatever I say is my truth and another truth is possible. Same way, do we use language with the awareness that what we express is not the same as reality? Right? We just use language, but we don't care that the meaning with which you are saying, whether the other person is receiving your words with the same meaning or not. Okay? And therefore we use words very loosely, without giving any context to those words. Now these are the two things which Korzybski identified, which leads to very inefficient time binding. Okay? Because we are not conscious of what brain is doing. We are not conscious of our process of abstracting. Now this lack of consciousness leads to so many things. It leads to issues of elementalism, identity, miscommunication. We completely ignore the word, the importance of silence. Okay? And then the ego is pampered, that I know everything, what I know is right, what I know is the only truth. And then we are not ready to take responsibility also. Okay? So there is no scope for a dialogue. There is no scope for acceptance. Because you are not conscious. You feel that everything you know is complete, is the final truth. Okay? And then the insanity or the insane behavior of humans come from all this, according to Korzybski. It's a complex quote, so I'll miss that. Now let us go to the last part of this lecture. So what? Now what to do? We have understood that we are experiencing in a very limited capacity. Our language has a lot of limitations. So I experience something which is incomplete. I transmit which is something incomplete. So now what I should do? Right? I can't stop looking. I can't stop hearing. Okay? I cannot improve my sense organs capacity because it is given to me. Right? And I cannot stop from abstracting. I cannot stop from using language. So what should I do? So these are the things which Korzybski suggests, prescribes in general semantics. First is, be conscious that you are abstracting. Okay? Always try to remember. It's a practice. General semantics, ye practice karne ki cheez hai. It's not something to read. And from my experience, I will tell you, it's extremely difficult. And it is difficult because our brains are rewired and rewired in such a bad way. We have done that. Okay? That again to unlearn, right, becomes extremely difficult. But this is what Korzybski is talking about. That whatever I say, I feel, what I am feeling are completely different happenings taking place at three different locations, three different time. Okay? And therefore you cannot grasp anything completely. So be conscious that you are abstracting. For that, he used the word non-Aristotelian system, which is very famous in general semantics. Because Korzybski has talked about how Aristotelian logic is wrong, so he proposes what is non-Aristotelian. This is the interesting part of Korzybski. He is not stopping at just telling you that this problem is. He is also trying to give you what can be done, what are the alternatives. And then he came up with non-Aristotelian system, which he has written in Science and Sanity, that don't take it as anti-Aristotelian. Jo Aristotle ne kiya tha, wo unke time ke hisab se barabar tha. Abhi hum jo kar rahe hai, wo apne time ke hisab se kar rahe hai. This is what time binding is all about. Where we are expected to correct the things as per the changing time. So what Korzybski is doing is only changing what Aristotle has given us. Okay, and making it more relevant to our times. And therefore, it's not anti-Aristotelian, but it is non-Aristotelian. Okay? And then he talks about map territory relationship. This is highly, I hope you will understand. The middle column, which you can concentrate, these are famous Korzybski's dictums. The map is not the territory. Correct? What is the meaning of it? in language reality, this you will understand. Map is not the reality, means words are not the things that they represent. Correct? Okay. This is water. But the word water, I cannot drink the word. I have to drink the water. Okay? Aristotle thought that the meaning is inside the word. Understanding that? The meaning is inside the word. Now we are understanding that the meaning and words are two different things. Okay? So words are, therefore you can, we should not take the words at the face value. That's what we say. Okay? So words are not the things that they represent. Second dictum is, a map covers not all the territory. That is, words cannot say all about everything. Clear? Even if you understand the last column, that is fine. We can use language to talk about language. Clear? And when we do that, I don't know what is called in English or Hindi. In Marathi, we call it as kan goshti. Lahan astana baryat janani khelala asel kan goshti. ओके okay? There is some line कि जो मैं एक मेरे नेबर को उनके उसके कान में बताऊंगा, वो अपने नेबर को बताएगा, अपने नेबर जब घूम के आएगा 50 लोगों से, तो लास्ट बंदा है जो बोलेगा क्या लाइन है, एंड इट इज कंप्लीटली डिफरेंट फ्रॉम द फर्स्ट वन. ओके, राइट? सो इट मींस दैट व्हेन वी अंडरस्टैंड, व्हेन आई ट्राई टू अंडरस्टैंड योर रियलिटी. ओके, मतलब फॉर एग्जाम्पल, इफ योर डिस्क्रिप्शन ऑफ फ्लावर से मैंने अंडरस्टैंड करने की कोशिश की वो फ्लावर क्या है, राइट? सो आई एम ट्राइंग टू अंडरस्टैंड द रियलिटी फ्रॉम योर रियलिटी, नॉट बाई एक्सपीरियंसिंग ऑन माई ओन. ओके, दैट इज, यू कैन टॉक ऑफ लैंग्वेज, यू कैन यूज लैंग्वेज टू टॉक अबाउट लैंग्वेज. ओके, विच एक्चुअली क्रिएट्स ए लॉट ऑफ प्रॉब्लम्स. Now, here comes last point, extensional devices. Now, these are the extensional devices which the Korzybski gives, okay, to avoid the issues of language. He says, use indexing, index everything. So, Muslim 1 is not Muslim 2. So, all Muslims are not the same. So, differentiate between all Muslims are same becomes Aristotelian logic. Okay, dating, Dipesh is not Dipesh, right? So Dipesh in 2017 is not the Dipesh who was in 2015. Everything tells us that, can you now understand, with these extensional devices, it tells us that the world is in process, right? The person has changed from 2015 to 2017. Okay, it's a process world. Use hyphens. We actually differentiate certain things, though they are actually the same. But our language differentiates between mind and body, but they are the same. So try to use the hyphens. Okay? Use quotes if you are going, you are using specific meaning. Use the word etc.
What was that earlier? Quotes.
Quotes. By intellectual achievement, I mean, what I mean intellectual achievement may not be what you mean. Right? कुठल्या तरी गावातल्या कॉन्फरन्समध्ये मी पेपर प्रेझेंट करून आलो, मी फेसबुकवर 10 वेळा टाकलं. Right? So that may be for me, that may not be for you. So if I want to say, and it may be okay, I am just a kind of a young person, you know, presenting first time, so I may feel it's a big achievement for me. Then use quotes when you're saying that. Use the word etc. always. Korzybski uses it a number of times. Or Institute of General Semantics ka jo magazine nikalta hai, journal nikalta hai, journal ka title bhi hai etc. etc. When you say etc., okay, it means that there is so much still to say. Okay, there is so much which I have not understood, but still I have to say that. Okay, or it is there. Okay, quantify. Right? एक ती ॲडव्हर्टाईजमेंट आहे ना एसीची, नवरा बायको म्हणतात 23 पाहिजे का 24 पाहिजे. ओके, सो इफ यू जस्ट से की इट इज हॉट, लेस हॉट, व्हेरी हॉट, बेटर टू क्वांटिफाय, से इट इज 45 डिग्री, सो थिंग्स आर क्लिअर. क्वालिफाय इट. ओके, जो मैंने शुरू में कहा, दैट व्हाट आई एम प्रेझेंटिंग इज एज पर माय अंडरस्टँडिंग ऑफ जनरल सिमेंटिक्स. यू मे हॅव अ डिफरंट अंडरस्टँडिंग, आय एम ओपन फॉर दॅट. ओके, सो टू माय बेस्ट नॉलेज, यूज द वर्ड्स इन माय ओपिनियन. Now this will make This will take you closer to the idea of time binding. Lastly, general semantics calls for what we call as non-verbal awareness, that is the importance of silence. If you remember structural differential, I've told you that the world is an object world. Okay? Right? But when we transform it into a subjective world of our own, and then there are problems. Can we understand the object world as object world without bringing language in it? Korzybski says that it is possible with what he calls practice of silence. And then number of techniques which he talks about. I don't have much time, so I'm not elaborating it. Turn down the volume and contemplating, semantic relaxation. All these are very important concepts in non-verbal awareness put forward by Korzybski. And he gives tremendous importance to being silent, okay, reducing the chatter of our mind, because when we are silent also we are talking, you know, in our mind. So even that talking has to be stopped, okay, which again, as I said, cannot be done immediately. It takes a lot of practice and time to do that. Korzybski feels that ki jaisa world object hai, objective hai, if we can experience that objective world as it is, okay, by bypassing the problems which are created by language, by bypassing the problems created by our human senses, okay, then he says that we are in a better position to have more deeper and fuller experiences, and therefore gives a lot of importance to non-verbal awareness. The second point, not the first point. He says that think silently, discover the structure of the silence or whatever you are experiencing at object level. Search proper structure of language which can match the structure of that silent process, and then try to express it verbally. We do exactly ulta as given in the first point. We start thinking verbally, okay, and then we start talking about non-verbal, which as per the Korzybski is a wrong way to do. It should be non-verbal to verbal. So finally, we end with this entire concept of efficient time binding. If we do that, if we do all this, which the GS prescribes, what is survival of fittest according to general semantics? Survival of fittest is how best you can survive in your time, how better you can bind time. Simple, were a concept to the personal time binding. What is that? Ki mi majas mistake madhun kai learn karu shakto. How much I can learn from my own mistakes in the past. Simple, it's a personal time binding. Okay? We carry the grudge. We blame ourselves for the mistakes that we have done. Korzybski says that don't blame from yourself. Learn from that mistake and forget that experience. That is the perfect time binding. And the person who binds time is fittest in time, or fit to survive. So finally, what Korzybski wants? Korzybski wants that we should behave like animals. We should stop fooling ourselves. We should not be animals. We are time binders, so we should practice time binding and conscious abstracting. We should inculcate scientific attitude. We should learn to unlearn. Practice silence. Lastly, GS might help us to answer our own present questions, to widen and deepen the horizon of our own gaze, so that what we want and what we achieve become truly worthy of ourselves as a time binder. It's a long quote. These are references. Those who are interested can take the website, the links. If you want to explore more on general semantics, generalsemantics.org, it's a web link of the Institute of General Semantics, where there's a lot of study material and, you know, number of things for download and all that is available, that you can learn from that. Lastly, ek chota sa dhaga hai ki jo art and general semantics la directly, tangibly lead kar. This is a photograph of Korzybski. In 1919, in World War, and you can see his wife, Mira Edgar Lee, who was a famous American painter, and painting on ivory was her skill. So Alfred Korzybski's wife, who who helped him to build the structural differential was a painter, was an American painter. These are some of her paintings. These are on ivory. Lastly, how General Semantics came to India? General Semantics came to India through this person, Mr. Balwant Parekh, who was the founder of the Pidilite Industries, the industry that makes Fevicol. And he introduced General Semantics in India in 2000s. And he founded Balwant Parekh Center for General Semantics and other human sciences in Baroda in 2009. And at present, that is the kind of a headquarter of General Semantics in India. Okay. Now, this Balwant Parekh Center has formed different nodal centers at different locations, such as Surat, Rajkot and all. One of the nodal center is in my college, and I am the coordinator of that center, where we run certificate courses from last 4 years, teaching General Semantics to our students. Thanks a lot. I know it was very difficult task. I hope at least one person you could have understood. Thanks.
We will begin with a short question answer session here, and I will begin with myself. Sorry. One thing I related is like if people have seen the film The Dead Poet Society. Yeah. If somebody has seen it, people are in love with it. I have seen it more than 15 to 16 times. Every time I watch each and every frame of it, and it's I keep on falling in love with it. In one of the scenes, the teacher, like I forget the actor's name, he mentions about the, the dangers of conformity. So more or less, the whole entire presentation kind of is emphasizing on that idea of the dangers of conformity.
Yes.
And in a very cliche way, in a very recent film of PK, even he is also referring to that idea of non-conformity.
Yes, yes.
And this is just a note which I related to.
We conducted one session on PK in our General Semantics course.
Okay. So now my question is, like, when we are speaking about non-conformity so much, like it's about challenging our ideas and ideals in at n number of levels. So what do we stick with, and how do we deal with that kind of amount of variation? Because this causes a lot of variation, and that's keeping finding answers is a good thing, which has helped to a great extent. But again, after a while, you understand that you cannot continue to challenge yourself consistently. Because somewhere you need to rest. So how do you respond to this problem?
To answer in General Semantics fashion, it's a choice. It's a choice of oneself. It's a personal choice. That if you want to be with a particular worldview or a particular understanding, then you can be with it. Right? But if someone wants to change, wants to challenge, wants to understand better, it's not challenging actually. It's more like knowing more about ourselves, knowing about how we think and how we experience. Because I think talking of our existence in this world and all, and who are we and all these are very eternal questions that every generation has raised the query. General Semantics will only tell you that the choice is yours. You test all these different worldviews or different ways of understanding yourself. Whatever you feel that it is right, empirically, I mean, okay, then you can stick to that. It's a personal choice.
Any question from the audience?
Reminded of Dead Poets Society. I was reminded of a film, a Japanese film called Rashomon.
Please hold it.
Rashomon. Have you seen it?
No.
You must screen it as part of your GS, because it is one incident which is interpreted completely differently by five different people were involved. And each one of them is involved in the incident. So conveniently they keep, whether you don't know that it is really or some subconscious report. I would like to enlighten you on this, GS method is a kind of a scientific method to arrive at non-verbal understanding of things. The Zen philosophy says exactly the same thing from a meditation point of view.
Yes.
I mean, the classical Zen statement is, if you want to see at once. If you begin to think, you miss the point.
Yes.
So it's very similar.
It is.
What do you think?
It is. But it's always better, you know, to experience that by doing it and to arrive at this particular conclusion. Because what I have presented is, I tried to be, you know, aloof from what I have presented. Right? If you ask me personally, my experience with GS in last 4 or 5 years, my conclusion at this point of time, which may change tomorrow, but my conclusion at this point of time is that it is scientific spirituality, which General Semantics is talking about. एक्चुअली नंबर ऑफ स्लाइड्स बहुत हो रहा था. मैंने कोशिश की थी कि कॉर्जिप्सकी के कोट के साथ मैं एक पैरेलल कोट जे कृष्णमूर्ति का दे, मैं निकाले भी थे वैसे भी पैरेलल्स टू जे कृष्णमूर्ति, बट एंड आई अवॉइडेड बिकॉज इट माइट हैव टेकन अस टू समथिंग एल्स, एंड देयर इज नो पॉइंट इन गोइंग डायरेक्टली टू दैट लेवल अनलेस यू नो प्रैक्टिस एंड गो थ्रू द प्रॉपर चैनल एंड देन यू कम टू दैट आइडिया. सो येस, इट इज मोर लाइक अ साइंटिफिक स्पिरिचुअलिटी. And the way you cannot, there is no point in talking of meditation unless you do meditation. The same, no point in talking of GS unless you practice GS.
It might be a very stupid question. तर ऐसा slides वर घातले और ते खूब detailed and it looked very difficult. But personally, I felt it was a very simple idea, which we complicate. I don't know why. But how do we teach this complicated idea to kids? Why do they have to?
There is a whole pedagogy of General Semantics teaching it. For the way we also teach in our certificate course, you know, with certain exercises, certain games, and all that. Because as I mentioned in my title, it's a tool. That is how I view it. There are some people who say that this tool is not a discipline, it's a subject. I never take it as a subject, I take it as a tool. Therefore, we are already designing a General Semantics Certificate course for my non-teaching staff. We are thinking of designing General Semantics course for the nurses in the hospital. So you can see that it depends upon ki aap kisko padha rahe ho, depends upon that what will be the pedagogy of that thing. There is a pedagogy of teaching it to the kids. If you want, I can share that document with you.
By kids, I mean, because this is the reality. There's no atomic science in this.
And as you said, it's correct that you find it very simple, right? But still, you feel that simple we are not practicing.
Yeah.
The simple things we don't practice. So it's necessary to understand that simple thing. And the slides, yes, I know you can. Because that every slide is a 2-hour session that we conduct in certificate course. And there are a number of loose ends that I have not explained because of time. So don't frame your opinion based on this presentation. Better read Korzybski on your own and take the decision. I'm just introducing you to this world.
Any more questions from the audience?
Not exactly question.
हा माझा क्लास असता तर मी एक्सरसाइज घेतली असती.
विच इज अगेन अ काइंड ऑफ अ कॉन्ट्रडिक्शन. वेल एनीवेज वी डोंट गेट इनटू दैट, बट या लेट्स स्टिक टू आत्मदीप भव एंड वी कंक्लूड सेशन बाय डॉक्टर कर्मकर हियर. एंड the next session is about a brief feedback or kind of a survey which we intend to do. So I'll be distributing some sheets to you and request all you to respond to the questions in that.
Response as well, but the reason of the survey is to just have a brief understanding what the audience members are thinking about these questions. And you need not answer each and every question there, because
the note mentions that please respond only to the questions which bear personal experience and thoughts. म्हणजे प्रत्येक प्रश्नाचे उत्तर द्यायचे असं गरजेचं नाही आहे. ज्या प्रश्नाशी तुमचा अनुभव निगडित आहे त्याच प्रश्नांना उत्तर द्या असं विनंती करतो, जेणेकरून आम्हाला ऑडियन्स म्हणून तुम्ही या कलाक्षेत्रात तुम्ही काम करताय तर त्याचा अनुभव काय आणि त्याचा विचार काय हे कळण्यास सोय होईल. आय रिक्वेस्ट एव्हरीबडी टू फिल इन द फर्स्ट टॉप पार्ट वेअर नेम अँड द कॉन्टॅक्ट डिटेल्स आर देअर.
Pardon? You didn't get it?
Your name.
Oh, I'm sorry.